No, but I just said it's 10:01, should I call the meeting?
You'd be in charge, Paul.
So, welcome everybody, and I thought we'd just start by welcoming Karen, our new trustee. Very, very much for stepping up, Karen.
Did you get sworn in?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, I meant to, I'm sorry, that was my.
It's okay, because I keep looking for it to bring them on the form, so it's a good thing.
Did you? I told her about Thursday, but I guess it happened anyway, so.
They had it in the morning, but we are supposed to, and I was down there, so she can come, so we'll go.
Okay, just give me a second. I have so many pieces of paper.
You're more patient than I am. I'm real patient, Paul.
So, first item on the agenda is approval of minutes. Andrew brought hard copies to the last trustee meeting, but didn't get me a electronic version, so I wasn't able to circulate it with the agenda. I did bring hard copies, but I'm not sure if we want to give up that much of the meeting to reading it in real time to approve, so what's your pleasure?
I have not seen them, I'd like a copy. Whether or not we take time for me to read it or not, I would like to.
Well, that's why I brought them.
I don't think that we have to approve them, so they could be.
Well, that's what I was thinking, but I thought I'd bring them anyway.
Besides, I didn't.
You'll notice that Andrew gave a summary of interview responses, but I sent out my earlier, not this last email, but prior to that, a more in-depth summary of the interview findings, so we might want to attach that to these minutes when we post them. Also, we might want to attach the full summary of the survey results as well, in the interest of transparency. One thing you'll notice is that with the pencil, I did the slight correction of the percentages, and we'll get into that, the correction of the survey results that I did over the last couple of weeks. So shall we table approval to the next meeting?
I think that's a good idea.
I think it's a good idea, we're going to need to spell it.
Yes, all right, good.
And can I ask you, Susan, you know how are this material sent to Sue Smith, is it?
Yes.
And so she puts it on the web?
Yes, yes. And I'm really glad I didn't have her post the survey results when I first created them, but I've been around the block long enough to know when you create something like this, you're going to find something. And the next week, they think, oh, I'm so glad I didn't post it. And so you have to leave it in your drawer for a while for that to surface. And that's my experience. Maybe you all don't make mistakes as regularly as I do.
Oh, absolutely.
I do. So, in keeping with our agreement at the last meeting, though there's nobody from the public here, I'm going to do it by the book anyway. We said, oh, like I said, I am a champion.
You're a invisible man behind the camera.
I'm trying to ignore the camera. It's so sarcastic. But I'm a champion and a statist. Sorry, Paul. I actually wrote down your presence. I want to recap what happened since the last meeting, since it happened offline. I sent out draft, preliminary, very preliminary draft mission, vision, values, and intended impact statements, asking for comments, thinking that our thinking could evolve between meetings, even though we don't make decisions between meetings. I did get comments from Gary, and we'll move to that agenda item shortly. But that's all that's happened between meetings. So keep that on the record. So the next item on the agenda is to review additional analysis of the survey. So here's the scoop. While I did note two or three paper surveys that I flagged as groups, I didn't catch in the Google Docs report the dupes from the online. So I went through that with a fine-tooth comb, used both their algorithm and also just compared the responses and found eight. The majority of those were submitted right after the Kate issued a reminder in June. So what I did in every case was to remove from the data set the survey with a later timestamp. And then I recalculated the percentages and updated them in the slide deck. So then after that, in response to the questions at the last meeting, I parsed, at least what can be parsed, the interest in various types of services and activities by subgroups. And I sent this with the agenda, but I know I sent a lot with the agenda, so I made hard copies. If we could just pass these around. Before we get to this, I want to say that when I removed the 8, the percentages changed very little, but I thought it was very important considering the concern about groups that they be removed and then the data be updated.
About minutes, since this is my first time doing this. Am I responsible for making sure that we just cover like what topics and the decisions, or do I need to verbatim?
No, not verbatim. Topics, decisions, you know, if there's a difference of opinion, I like to summarize that there was a difference of opinion around this particular
thing. Okay.
It's not a transcription.
Okay, yeah. Just trying to be clear because I'm typing fast here.
So
it's hard to do that and not make a transcript, which I think because you're listening.
Yeah.
And you have to go back and take all this extra notes.
Yeah.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
So,
no problem.
I'd like to just take a little side note here, 30 seconds. I'm really sorry that Andrew wasn't able to come this morning. You can't plan for a few months, obviously. But I just wanted to restate my personal opinion that having Gary and Cindy at the table is essential, because whatever plan we develop in order to succeed will need the support of leadership throughout the town, not just one subgroup of the town and its interests. So it just is essential that you're here, and I really appreciate it. Statement on the record. So, as you'll see this, I also wanted to say, you could ask me, what about this group or that group? I didn't parse by every subgroup. It was extremely laborious because Google only would give me these responses in a string, separated by commas, within one cell in Excel, and they weren't even in the same order. So I had to, by hand, code every response for every subgroup. It took a long time, so you have to really be sure you want another set of data.
You should hold me up. I'll give another program out of the frame.
Okay.
Next time.
Can I ask, what was the...
It would have been laborious, so if you see the way it's...
Oh, no.
Okay.
What are the numbers for paper surveys versus online?
Like 22 to 25 paper surveys.
Oh, so most of them were online.
Yeah, all online. And we're down from 117 to 109. So N is smaller, but not so much smaller that removing the 8 substantially changed the percentages. Even so, it's a totally legitimate question to ask, and they needed to be taken out. So that's what was for correcting. That's me. So you'll see here, there's not a lot of difference among these groups, except for current library users who are substantially more interested in every service, which is what we would predict. But I expected more difference between long-term Grafton residents and newbies like myself. It's really not that significant. A few are higher. For example, more new people are interested in downloadable books. A notable difference in that person. Does anybody else see anything that they would like to call out?
Well, I'm going to make a constant comment. I find it interesting that the movie, what do I call it, DVDs checkout is always a substantial number, it seems, on the monthly reporting, which I didn't write. But
versus like a book where it takes you
a week to read it.
So that would be.
We do have like several patrons who get like 5 movies at a time weekly.
Yeah.
And this is a vote of one.
Right.
Each individual. So that makes a big difference.
Well, I still think it's particularly important for our library, given the high cost of streaming services or any other way of accessing movies. I think it's a really important service that we offer, even if it's just 40% on the server.
Oh yeah, I'm not complaining about that. Yeah. I'm just surprised by why, and now I have an answer to why.
Okay. I just wanted to, any other comments on this data? Based on what they say they might be interested in on a survey. It's just, that would be nice, but you never do it.
Right.
So the meaning behind a person selecting something varies. And that was the other comment that I wanted to make about the survey, because there was a lot of interest, at least from one member of the public, on how it was developed and how it would be used. It's a survey. It's not an algorithm. It doesn't dictate what we decide. It's information, and with all of its flaws, but I don't think it's so flawed that it isn't useful, but we get to decide how much weight to give it. And that's why I don't really want to spend more time parsing it, because it's not going to help us make our decisions.
And another thing I noticed, too, in looking at the information you provided last month, some people put in that they would like to see the library have services that the library already provides. So this may be people who would like to do that, but didn't know they already could.
Right.
I think so. And the way the question was posed is, how do you use or would like to use the library? And some of those were to detect interesting things we do and don't have. Like I saw in so many libraries, when I did the research about rural libraries, so many of them offer free museum passes. So I put it in a list, and one person said, I didn't know we had free museum passes. We don't, but there was keen interest in that, for good reason. It's expensive to take a family to a museum. So.
Yeah, I think the surveys can also be informative.
Right, that's the...
To the survey, or the survey.
So that's why I put that there. The percentage of people who said they wanted to use it was not really high, but not negligible either. So that informs us in what kind of facilities, and I'm not saying how we address the facility issue here, but what kind of facilities or other adjustments.
Since we're talking about the noise issue, can I make a comment? I had to delete a particularly foul post from Facebook, but the content was good. It was the content, the point was useful, the delivery was whoop. You did. Do you agree with my assessment?
Yeah.
Oh, that's even
better.
I can say what I'm not in care of. There were foul words. but basically the comment was that this person had received several complaints that they wanted to have be able to use the library in a quiet time. And that was kind of the space. But, you know, I'm going to reach out to that person and say, yeah, that's what we're really grappling with here, aren't we? Like, you know, we're really grappling with the point that this building right now is single purpose.
It is single use.
To speak anything about the whispering that library is like.
Yeah.
It's so small.
It's so small, and it's just, it, yeah, it just is what it is. And so there are competing visions for how people want to use the library that are not compatible.
Current.
And so we will get to that.
But these are good indicators.
They are, I think they're good, and that, I think that's the perfect word, they're indicators. You know, how we interpret them, how we decide, how much weight we decide to give this is up to us.
I think too sometimes a lot of people, what they really say they want isn't always what they really want because
you
found that it's
probably more important to know what you just said, but look at the actual statistics to see what they've shown in the past that they actually demonstrated the fact. Not so much what they think they want, sometimes it's me.
Well, you know, I think that's exactly right. And when I used to do market analyses for senior housing, mixed income senior housing, I found that people put way too much weight in what folks said they would like to have. And I said, you need to analyze data about who's chosen to be here or in a comparable facility. What is that profile? That tells you far more than would you like this or would you like that. So I think we need to compare these data with our utilization data.
Yeah.
But also be careful about that, because if it's low, does that mean there's not interest, or does it mean there's another issue that's driving it?
Right.
We don't know.
Right.
Something like the printer, for example, everybody wants to be able to print things locally, but you probably only need that once a year personally, if you're living in town.
But it tells us they want the utility of it.
Right,
So we'll get to that.
And do you need it during one of the 12 hours that it's open?
Do our best to come to consensus around guiding concepts. So our mission, which is the purpose of the library, our vision, where we want to drive it within 5 years, that's my definition of vision. Some planners mean what kind of world would we create if we met our mission, and I'm more interested in having a specific vision. I'm passing it around. So that you have benchmarks for how do we know we're achieving our vision. So that's the intended impact. So those are the four statements on which we can build, decide upon our strategic priorities, the basic hows of how we're going to move from where we are to where we want to be, and the implementation plan. So getting this, and my goal for today is to see how much consensus we can develop, knowing that our thinking is sure to evolve over the next 2 months. Because sometimes you come to an agreement and it unravels a little bit, and I'm saying up front, that's okay. We have till September to get it, and we can revisit without reinventing the wheel any decisions that we make today. So I sent these out because I find that when you put things in writing, when people disagree, they know sharply how much they disagree, which is why I could be vulnerable and just put it out there for you to pick apart. I really appreciate Gary having gotten back to me. And Gary, tell me if I captured this right or wrong. My understanding was that you felt they didn't quite address two things. One, yes, we want to serve the Grafton community, but since we're small to do so, we should bring higher in visibility our intention to collaborate with surrounding libraries to develop a consortium of libraries. That's sort of buried in it, maybe one or two sentences down, but perhaps we want to elevate it. Perhaps that's a strategic priority, you know, one of the primary ways that we move towards our vision. The other comment you made, which I was sure somebody would make, is the mission of the library about meeting community needs beyond the traditional function of the libraries? For example, social service needs or community building needs. Recreation, doesn't that more properly belong to other groups? I think that's a question that's like front and center for what we want to decide in terms of the mission, right? And I think you also made the comment, you know, how about addressing that again in collaboration with other groups in town, which is something I absolutely favor. That we're too small to have fiefdoms in Grafton, and we need to be doing things together. But sometimes it seems that the smaller a human organization, the more fragmented, which is odd, but I've seen that happen in communities as well. So
it is odd.
It is odd. But have you seen? I've seen that. Oh, we see it here.
Thousands of lives. I mean. So that's in terms of other libraries and other orgs in Grafton, right?
Mm-hmm. we could move the paper, you know.
Yeah, we could. Maybe I'll join
you. Need to strengthen
it. I just need to be told the obvious in case you haven't noticed. Revision, which is just a starting place. It's usually a good idea to indicate what impact you're trying to create, and then maybe touch on how you plan to do it. So that's why I started with two overarching impacts, which may or may not be what we choose: advance lifelong learning and strengthen the Grafton community. How do we do that? We access to these three things that we spent, and I brought local up. So why should we have a local library when we're so small and Canaan's bigger? And for many people in Grafton, Canaan's closer. Mm-hmm. So those are the kinds of things, successfully or not. I was trying to pack into also a shorter statement. I think shorter is usually better.
I really like the way it reads.
I do too. To me, it reflects the original one. It just tightens it all up.
Yeah. Well, I also tried to. We talked about mission, and you all gave me input as to what elements of the samples I gave you that you liked.
The only thing that stood out to me is just.
why you say, yeah, but like, so media is a catch-all, but if it doesn't communicate and people read it and say, huh, what about books, then,
I think that's how we ended up with it, and, because I was there when we drafted the current one, and I think that's how we ended up with it in there, because we...
Oh, define.
I actually, in my notes, I just wrote down to add the word literature. Free access to literature, media, programming, et cetera.
That's only one extra word, and it does solve the problem.
It does.
Even though you could say, and I did, I Googled this, I said, what does media comprise?
Right.
And then I Googled, is literature media?
Right.
I don't know if somebody I was waiting for somebody to say that. Yeah. I stuck on.
But you already put in more effort than most people who read that and are going to get upset about it, avoid it.
You're absolutely right. Okay.
Does varied media sources solve it?
Well, I think it's still if people aren't savvy or sophisticated or up to the moment as to what media comprises in 2021, it doesn't communicate.
Yeah,
and the last thing we want in any of these statements is anything that's jargony or people don't immediately understand. I mean, we can write about it in whatever language we want, but these statements have to be really clear.
Mm-hmm. So have we agreed? Are you going to insert one word? I don't
for
want
now.
Any words.
So here's for now. No, we're not going to go down. We're not going down a rabbit path. This is a really good suggestion. I suggest we add it, and that what we're aiming for today is preliminary consensus, knowing that somebody's going to have a better idea over the next 2 months about something. But so we just need working statements so we can move on to the strategies and implementation.
So where
is there anything else? The first question I think that we should move and vote on is, do we want to update the mission statement? Sorry to be so picky, but I want to be honest with you about that.
I think
are you looking for a motion?
Yes.
Oh.
I really want to play this
I
can go. Who decided?
You
move that we update the mission statement.
Yes, including this little edit.
She's not asking for specifically approving this, but saying,
yes,
do we even want to update the mission statement?
That's the first decision.
Okay.
Exactly.
I do.
Okay. I'm not voting.
I'll second George's motion.
All in favor? Oh, very slowly.
Typically, mission statements are very general anyway. Or I hate to say, Jesus' word, there's in some ways motherhood. So I mean, the real devil is in the details. When you get further on,
However, you're absolutely right. And when you get down the road, the question always, especially if there's disagreement, is that aligned with the mission or is it off mission? And some hard decisions have to be made that way. And your mission statement has to at least provide guidance. It can't be so general that it doesn't help you answer that question as to whether something is consistent with the mission or. You know, you've heard the term mission creep.
Well, it generally determines what direction you want to start out in, how far you go, if you even intend to keep going in that direction. Amazing, see?
Right. You know, you're absolutely right.
So do we have consensus or not, Gary? I'm confused.
About,
did you vote yes or not?
Did.
Okay.
It's like. So, I think since we're not making a final decision, I'm just looking for a straw vote. Can we move ahead with this statement and Cindy's amendment as our working mission statement? We're not voting on it yet. It's not final.
So, all right, so I record that in the minutes as our...
It's tentative.
Our
working mission statement.
Working mission statement is...
To be finalized at a future meeting.
Okay.
Can I just ask real quick, Elaine, you were part of creating this current mission statement?
Yeah.
Was that a revision of an old one as well, or was that the first time one was put on paper?
I think that might have been the first time it was put on paper. I don't remember.
Yeah.
I'd be shocked.
Actually, I think it wasn't the first one.
Okay. Thank you.
And when we get to Gary's point, the word services, I want to think about what does that mean, services?
I have an example that answers, part, not answers, but fits in that question. Do you want an example? So in this meeting, you told me about the Massapequa Senior Center and how they provide rides to doctor's appointments. I didn't know that. My Uncle Jim needed that desperately because he's fallen 4 times and I had to drive down and help get him up. As a chemo patient. And so having that service that can come and help my aunt get him in a vehicle so that he can go to his doctor's appointment really connected them with a service that's available. And I think we had talked about that early on, was just maybe the library, one of the library's purposes is to connect people with information that gives them services. So not necessarily providing the service, but
the service would be the
service
is connected. And you know, I think I'm circling services because I think we will circle back to that. I lost my train of thought.
I'm sorry.
I think it's all on my mind. It's just a question in my own mind, and I think Gary's right. That gets flushed out.
Oh, here's the point I was going to make. I don't think this implies, but if it does to the capital reading, we'll need to change it, that the library would provide all the services Grafton residents need.
Right.
It just says services, and a response
right.
would be, well, the unmet need is information and a connector, and that's what we're doing. Then Gary's question, is that the role of the library? Is a pertinent one. We need to ask ourselves, do we think that's the role of the library? In many rural communities, people have given that question a resounding yes. That doesn't mean we have to. So I just raised that. So I'm circling services as something to circle back to. Should we move on to vision? I think that's okay. This is where I'm hoping, expecting, a lot of pushback and input, because we need to decide what this plan is designed to achieve. Where do we want to drive the library? What should it look like in 2026? And this is...
I mean, I really like this welcome and well served, because I think that's what some of the complaints we're hearing get at. People, there are people who do not feel welcome there.
Absolutely.
I've had to kind of modify how I use the library, because I know that my kids come in there and it's burning me out. So I don't feel like I can just come down whenever.
The sad part about that is there are times when you don't feel welcome.
Right, exactly. That's exactly right.
That's the conundrum with our space. But we'll get to
yeah,
that.
But I think, you know, there are people who want it quieter, and so they don't feel welcome. There are people who, you know, want to connect with community, but, you know, they're getting complaints about it, you know. So I think there's a lot of competing needs in that space.
Quite understand that if you do not feel welcome because you don't want to connect with community, is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying that my kids take over.
They're loud.
They're loud.
They're kids.
They're kids. And so I don't feel that it's right, comfortable. I'm a Yankee girl. I'm a Husky girl. I feel very uncomfortable inflicting my kids on people who are trying to listen to their classical guitar music, like Chris Pope does, or kids who are, you know, people who are trying to get their taxes done, or whatever. When I come in there with my 3 kids, it is burgundy time, and nobody's getting anything done.
Well, and part of this too, these are ongoing issues. I mean, these things have been going on for years, and this whole, we're not going to do anything different until we get a brand new library. I just find appalling.
Yeah.
But we could have already addressed this. This could already be replaced.
This is a
fine. There could be children's time. There could be quiet time. These, you know, these things could already be established so that you know. This is when all hell breaks loose.
This is burning any time.
Well, and she's not that fun with children who I've heard about. Yeah,
yeah,
kind of take
children.
I mean, I've kind of settled into it.
And adults, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, adults.
And there's some adults that are,
yeah,
it's best worse.
Nobody gets
any. Well, you know, this is, you know, I don't want this to get too long, a vision statement, but sort of what I meant by optimizing hours of operation.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Just like designated at certain times, somehow finding a way to be open more hours without increasing the budget. Now, I don't know what the rules are, Kate, about when you can be open, and does it have to be paid staff? I don't know the rules. I just know that 12 hours a week is insufficient for a lot of us, especially since, you know, when those times happen. And if we say, this is just for children, we're limiting further for other people. So that's why I said optimize, not maximize, because we don't have the money to maximize. But
it's already maximized.
yeah.
We've spoken about volunteers. They run the libraries, they're doing some period. The question, the detail I want to get clear, I haven't had a chance to check it out. Somewhere I've run into volunteers are not allowed to replace paid staff or in lieu of paid staff or something. So it seems to me, as soon as we enter volunteers are going to run some hours at the library, we're already in trouble. If that turns out to be true. Because I was banking on volunteers. We talked once about an active volunteer program. Ooh, I don't know if that's going to get in our way.
And then there's also, you know, I think we talked about before, certain types of volunteering require like background checks. If they have anything to do with children.
Right.
And there can be no circulation of any media or anything done by a volunteer.
And there's money in there. Can be money in
there. Yeah.
What's the source of that?
Well, the last one was the rules set on. Oh, what rules? The one I'm referring to?
Yeah, no,
it's a public, it's labor law. It's labor law.
And also, the New Hampshire State Library has like volunteer best practices that they put out, too.
But then how do they do that? So maybe I could be wrong. I hope I could. Because then they must be having volunteers run things in lieu of paid staff. Yeah.
So I know that like Amy Gerber, for example, she runs almost all of the programming, but she has volunteers, you know, help her.
But she's present. So it's under that auspices. That's a different setup. Now they're eating her,
right. Not
running the program.
But I mean, do you really need to have someone present, or do you just say, there's people under the overall responsibility and your supervision, and they can work independently?
So
I think that it's clear to me, and it sounds like to other people, that thoroughly investigating and the role of volunteers, what the role of volunteers can be, how we can increase volunteer involvement to achieve our vision, is got to be something that we do down the pipe and will be part of the implementation plan.
I'll find out before then.
Pardon me?
I'm going to find out before then.
Well, you can find out as
much as
you can. But even when you find that out, we still need to figure out what kind of volunteer program we want, what would it take to implement it. There's a lot of devil in those details as well.
Yeah.
But my question is, what's missing from this vision statement? Where did we get it wrong? It doesn't say build a new library.
It says offer
facilities that accommodate our program. So I just want to make that point.
I have a little detail. We use the word overdrive.
Yeah.
Who's going to know what that means?
Well, exactly.
So I think we need to make it something else.
Free downloadable books.
Yeah, at least that tells us what it is, or the reading what it is.
Yeah, because I never heard of overdrive unless it has to do with a vehicle.
The car.
I never had either. That's why it's
Yeah. And I think, and part of a vision. And for me, my eyes, I can't read most printed books anymore because the type's too small, which is why I use my Kindle all the time. And I represent a huge percentage of our download statistics. So it is it's an adaptive future.
I think it's a total future. A lot of people don't know that.
So the last phrase, I guess, is support quiet use of the library for me, which I totally agree with. But also, I think somewhere we need to provide like opportunities for people to meet with friends and neighbors, because that's a big part of it.
Well, that's something we need to talk about.
Yeah.
Because I think it's both, and that's a big part of what we're struggling with, the gap.
Yes, and I think we should discuss that head on.
I think that goes back to what Susan said before about that Gary mentioned, is it a traditional library that we're looking to do or something completely different? Because in my head, that would never be something a library should do. That's not a library's for. A library is where you go and you get books and you're quiet and you know, it's not a social gathering place.
But libraries all over the place have things like a fine arts club.
Sure.
Oh, absolutely. Hours.
Yeah.
You represent a generation that's.
Yeah, I don't know.
I follow. Because that was my. You library. No, maybe you don't.
But
know.
I think it's an accurate.
That was
my
first kind of comments. Like, what is
they're,
all this?
Right. They're not competing visions.
Right. They don't need to be.
They don't need to be competing visions.
And in a job where you only can socialize at the dozen or the post office, it would be nice.
So this is an interesting point. Could you repeat that?
In a town where the only place you can bump into your neighbors or for people to meet in Grafton, in a public arena or whatever.
Dump in the.
It would be nice to have a place to run into. People you know besides the recycling center, what used to be known as the dump, or the post office. It would be,
yeah.
I mean, I think in a town of this size with very little space to socialize, I mean, there's no restaurants or anything, I think the library would be doing a good thing to not follow the tradition of this is all about books and other media, but that it also would be a valuable service to the community to have a social aspect to it.
Because it's part of being innovative and also serving the community. The community needs a meeting space to gather.
And it's not good for isolation. Isn't very good for mental health. And people are usually good for people.
Yay, 2020.
Do you need to have the library being the specific place for that?
Exactly.
Or can I just get involved with other areas and organize using those other areas, like the town hall, the new cook shack, or whatever?
Or something, I understand, I think one of the biggest things that came out of the survey so far is that there is a need for a community center in this town. There's a desire for it, and there would probably be support for it. Where I'm trying to connect the dots between this and that is that the library, should that be under the auspices of the library trustees? Or is that a community center that should be that the select board would oversee, that would be more open to everybody and not just a library building.
I think that's the question we're addressing. The only thing I want to throw out there, which again is not, doesn't determine what we must decide, but just to make the remark that libraries in rural communities across the country are adopting that mission. Doesn't mean we have to.
Adopting
the mission of the phrase that we often
hear or see in the literature is libraries, the living room of the community.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to Prescott, I'm in the process of moving my eldest son and family to Prescott.
Oh.
It's only 8 hours drive. But in any case, the library there on the front glass says, Prescott lives here.
Mm.
In big letters,
sure.
So they've adopted that.
Sure.
And as I'm saying, so that is considered consistent with the mission of libraries in many communities. But communities are run by the local people, and we can make that decision for ourselves as to whether we adopt that or not. So I think the point that's often made in the literature that I read is that often the library is the only place, because there is no community center,
right,
where
right.
people can run into each other and socialize,
sure.
other than the recycling center. So they adopt that mission because, you know, to get back to Gary's point, there aren't other groups or facilities that meet that need.
Mm-hmm.
And is there a snowball's chance, you know, where that there ever will be a community center?
There's always a chance.
Well, there's a chance of anything, but
sure.
I mean,
will you consider a community center? Could the town hall be a community center? Anybody can go there, organize any function they want, and invite anybody they want. Right? The entire town. You can have a potluck, you can have a fair, craft fair, or whatever. Someone just has to take the action and the responsibility to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't rely on all the same government people to be organizing all these functions. People need to get involved. They have the facilities to do it. They need more. Well,
that's
I think right now we haven't really shown that those facilities, and these facilities, are overused and not meeting anybody's needs. So,
sure.
I agree with a lot of theory, but I would want to say this: when we have the example right in front of us. When the community is left for someone to generate something, it doesn't seem to happen. We have a group Thorbo, and they have energy, and they bring events. Right? And to me, it doesn't mean the library has to be where the events are held, but we could be a facilitating force to get, I don't know, somebody to do potluck lunches or dinners or something. I mean, to be a, what's the right word, a catalyst for, not that we have to run them all, but that we can be a facilitator. So I kind of see that as an important role. We don't have anything happening of that nature right now. And from my limited experience, this town never has, except when there used to be churches. You know, but so I worry about just free form, let it happen with no right word, energy behind it or something.
I think another
thing is, someone is still having to take the action to do.
Mm-hmm. Somebody has to take the action. I mean, we have to take the action.
That's right. So it's someone in the library or someone outside.
Correct.
Why would it have to be?
Somebody's got to be the catalyst to start it off. Is it that the select board? That hasn't happened. Has it been the rec committee? No, they have a little handful of events, but they're very introspective groups.
Why would we be a government facility or a
I think because that's how people use it. That's how they're using the library now. They're using it to connect with their community.
And to the extent that they can.
To the extent that they can. And I think that, you know, the survey has shown that they do want to. And so I think it makes sense in their minds that that be the place to do it. You know, if you have a place that has comfy chairs and whatnot. I mean, we have our formal meetings here, and it's very uncomfortable. It's not a place you can just sit and kind of casually sit back and just chat. And, you know, it's we're there for business. We get in, we do our products, we do meetings, we get.
It's very hard to do.
It's really hard to.
Oh,
right. To share in there.
another is a drop-in sort of environment.
Yeah.
Where it isn't scheduled and people don't have to decide, I'm not comfortable with that group or I am comfortable with that group, but a place where everyone feels comfortable and you can drop by and run into
people. As many people as possible.
So I'm just putting it out that we don't have that, and I think the approach of getting people to organize more scheduled events, say here, wouldn't necessarily address that. Libraries are addressing that in rural communities across the country, but it's our decision whether we want to adopt that or not.
Aren't those rural libraries bigger than one schoolhouse?
Most of them are. If you look at the data, they're just going to find it here, but the median size of rural libraries is 2,500 square feet. That's it. We're going to be referring back to this data.
So you have 660.
Yep, that's
yeah.
Right.
So that makes it really complicated.
It's very complicated.
Is your definition of rural only by the situation? I mean, is it by population?
The definition in this is this document from American Library Association. It's serving communities of 2,500 people.
Okay. Well, that's one thing we just keep going back to with different things people ask for
right.
Before, and it's like, I hear all the time, well, but Enfield does this. Well, Enfield has a lot more people and they have a bigger budget. And we can't, let's not compare that. That doesn't. I mean, Enfield's only good from the perspective of the types of services that people can need in this area,
mm-hmm.
You know, just based on our unique geography.
Yeah.
So, does anyone have a suggestion for how we could move through this wicket? Because it's a really central issue of our vision and the goal of our library. And I would like to separate, to the extent we can, discussion of facility and just talk about what's our vision, what would we hope the library could do? And then we'll look at what's real.
So
what's
we
possible.
Needed to add in Gary's suggestion about collaboration, right? That we
yes.
decided that that should go into
this.
Yes, yes, I've added it in my words.
Oh, so are we not refining this right now?
What I'm looking for right now is what concepts don't belong in here, and what are missing here. That's what I'm looking for.
Okay.
George.
I'm a little concerned that following Overdrive, or maybe it's the next line, provide accessible facilities and accommodate. I'm a little worried that last statement suggests an endorsement for a different building. And it really just all lined up.
Well, it would if you assume that the library building has to be the facility that accommodates programs.
But
if it doesn't,
but the library trustees have no say over other buildings, so this should be specific to what the library trustees have responsibility for, can do. I agree with George, but I think it's the word programs that throws that off. I think accessible facilities that comfortably accommodate library patrons. I think that for me,
okay.
that was the word that kind of threw
okay.
it off.
Okay.
Yeah, programs to be implies something.
Right.
Well,
right.
I think I can see that.
It might not fit. I mean.
No, I like the swap of patrons there and patrons of what? You know? Patrons of cruising the stack or patrons of programs that we put together, but it's available for this instance.
I have to thank
Does
you.
That work for you, George?
I thank you. It works better for me. Yeah, and you know, Susan, I want to thank you for what you've done. This to me represents a lot of work.
Absolutely.
A lot of thinking, a lot of writing. Thank you for that.
You're welcome. You're right.
And if you said that.
Yeah, but right ahead.
Then
I told you what it's for. It's just
he's building you up so they can carry
it. I have a friend who always said, lather then shave. So you just lather.
So my question then. Okay, yeah.
And in fact, it's less public, it's more, you know, how do we hold ourselves accountable?
Right.
How do we get, you know, how do we translate this vision into concrete stuff?
These are the measures.
That we're saying, you know, this is what we're trying to do, and this is how we'll hold ourselves accountable.
Did I miss something? Did we move all the vision?
No, we didn't, he just was asking.
I did, yeah, I didn't know if you needed to come on.
Should we move George away from you?
I know.
I hate to be a broken record, but I do think that we can't slide over the question of whether the library should be a place that serves this need for connecting with different visitors.
Identify who should do it. Who else? If it's going to be done at all. How else will it get done? As I said, it isn't happening now.
Well, I think we see a need, but is it the need that we adopt? Is the question.
I don't see how we can.
Yeah, if we can, then why not?
I think, from my perspective, that's how people are already using the library and how people are saying they want to use the library.
Yes.
So those two things together, it's how can we not?
And also, if our mission statement is, you know, positive going to be to strengthen the Grafton community, a lot of that is just getting to know your neighbors randomly, seeing who they are.
Yeah, face to face, not through a third party.
Yes.
You need a lot of that.
Yes.
But it's a choice. And I'm being quiet because I'm not answering this question.
So how are you suggesting that we come to an answer as a result?
Yeah, I'll tell you, it would probably make people uncomfortable, but we could take a straw vote as to who thinks that's part of mission/vision and who doesn't, and keep the conversation going, because I think it would be a real mistake not to address this question head on. That's my opinion as a facilitator.
Gary, I watched the planning board meeting, which, wow. but it seemed like the planning board, they were suggesting that they felt the community also wanted less of just the traditional services and more community, meeting community needs.
Yeah, I mean, there's no problem with that. I mean, it's all a question of what other services those are.
Okay.
I mean, I didn't hear anyone say they had to have specific.
No. Yeah. And I think the planning board makeup has changed since the land was donated by Mr. Gray.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember that I looked it up. the planning board at that time said that they were okay with the selectmen accepting the donation on the condition that no additional taxpayer money would ever be needed to do whatever was going to be done there.
Is that within their purview?
Yeah.
No. You were asking about how the planning board felt about something.
Yeah.
I was just saying that. I know at that time, that's what they were saying was that.
Yeah.
And it's kind of a ridiculous thing, really, to even say, because of course there's going to be taxpayers money needed to pay for the electricity. You know, something's going to be needed. But I think their general consent, their general feeling at the time, was the way I read it was, sure, that's all well and good if you can move that library over using the funds you. Because that was the plan at the time.
Yes. Yep.
And they were kind of saying, if you can do that with the money that's been raised by Fogle or whatever, all the other donations, that's all well and good. But if it's going to cost taxpayers, you know, another $50,000, $100,000, whatever, then we're against it, was what they were saying at the time.
Okay.
Well, I just would like to suggest, of course, these two issues are very much related, building and building and adopting this aspect of the mission. Inextricably linked. We could decide, I think the first decision is might decide that we got to fulfill it with the resources we've got and do as best we can with what we've got. Or, you know, down the pipe, decide whether it involves creating a new facility. But I don't think it necessarily means that we say this is part of our mission, we're endorsing a building project. It doesn't mean that. So, and this is to get back to what George has been saying right along, we need to define what we're about first before we start talking about real estate. So, feel free to disagree.
And demonstrate, I'm with you. When this building is fully subscribed, then you can make an argument that we need another one.
Sure.
I don't think we're anywhere near there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I don't think that's the trustee's job to do that.
No, I understand that.
Yeah.
But how are you going to convince voters that you need more space when the space you've got isn't being used? I worry about that. But that's, I don't want to get this off on
the table. So the question on the table, in my mind, is does Strengthen the Grafton Community belong in a mission statement? And do we want something in the vision that says we're facilitating opportunities for neighbors to meet and interact?
That absolutely falls under strengthening the community.
It does. But the first question is strengthening the community part of our mission.
Okay, so I think it is.
Let's do that one first.
Oh, we did.
Yeah, we did.
We did.
Yeah. Oh, no, we didn't. No, we didn't.
I don't think so. I'm sorry to be such a stickler, but I've seen so many things in this town just keep evolving.
Yeah. Yes.
And I just want to say, yes, no. Lay it out like that on the record.
Okay, so I'm going to cast my vote in favor of inclusion for the
Strengthening the Grafton.
Right. In both places.
Can I ask a question? Do I put this under the mission section of the minutes?
Yes,
under
let's do that.
Thank you.
To reiterate, paraphrase, George moves that Strengthen the Grafton Community, or words to that effect, be included in the mission of the library.
Yes.
So, anyone want to second that?
Oh, because it's not specific to the library, you're saying you don't think it should be in the mission statement. I see.
Why don't you go to the select board or the taxpayers and say, you think we ought to strengthen the community? Or we ought to say everybody should be strengthened.
Mission. If it is an explicit element, then an appropriate question at a board meeting is, how We circulate books, we do this, we do that, and it's just not part of our mission to be bringing people together or strengthening the community. So it's just a matter of, do we want to be explicit?
It's our why. The whole thing is why we are doing the services and etc.
Because if you left, right,
motivation.
Yeah, if you took that out and just added to advanced lifelong learning, then that kind of goes back to what you said before, then you're going to stick with the narrow definition of what a traditional library is, like what George and I's generation says the library is supposed to be.
But I've learned differently. Today it's different. It is.
I'm not disagreeing with that. Yeah. When I said that, I was just letting people know I'm stuck in this whole
world. But it should be both. It's not, like, that's sure. Not. It should also be that.
Right.
Right.
Agree.
I think we can record this vote, and I think it's important to record it. Did you abstain or did you vote no?
I think I abstained.
Okay, but that's fine, because that's where we're at. That's where we're at as a group right now.
Right.
So I think it's fine for that to be reflected.
Okay, do I need to record why?
Why you abstained?
Yes.
It might be worth pointing out, just so we know
just so
what
we know
the listening was.
Right.
We have to revisit.
So
this.
Is it accurate if I say that you're unsure why the library should explicitly call out strengthening the community? Is that accurate?
It's part of our mission. It's part of the library.
As part of the library.
Why is it specific?
To the library.
Okay.
Why does it need to be specific?
Because.
Yeah.
And that's a legitimate question, and we should continue to think about
why does it need? I want to be accurate. Why does it need to be the library? Is that what you said?
And why does it need to be specific to the library?
Okay. Why does it need to be specific? I'm sorry. I made you go through that thing.
I think, in my mind, the answer is it doesn't need to be. It's a choice.
Mm-hmm.
It's a choice.
And that's why I'm raising it, because it is a choice. But if we make that choice, then there has to be elements of the implementation plan that address it.
Right.
If it isn't a choice, then we don't have to address it in the implementation.
And I guess I'm hearing again Cindy's idea, and I like it. Every group ought to have something to do with this. Every group. And if every group had it, it seems to me intergroup coordination would become a different animal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like that.
Let's don't forget I also said it's a thank you.
Measuring the strength of the community.
No.
dots piece.
Right.
And here's the connect the dots piece. If there is good evidence that doing X leads to these kinds of outcomes in communities, then you say, oh, based on that evidence, we're choosing to do these things. And we'll measure the extent to which we're doing that well. And we can expect, given the research, that this will have a positive impact on the community. Because we'll never have resources to do thoroughgoing evaluation. That's expensive, to do it in any kind of meaningful way. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's very busy.
Yes,
job.
Right. So you have to rely on what we know about the impact of this type of activity in a community. And that's why we choose to do it.
Maybe a way we could tweak it, not to get stuck on this, I don't mean to move forward, but maybe to consider for next time as we're moving through this, what this mission statement is. Maybe something to consider would be, if you have to advance lifelong learning and strengthen the community, what if there was something more like to advance lifelong learning and community spirit? So it was more, these are these two things we would like to advance. So that strengthening the community doesn't become a separate
thing. Can you say that one more time?
That's
to advance lifelong learning and community spirit.
So that it's, we're advancing these two things. We're not saying we're going to strengthen something, or we want to strengthen something that's immeasurable to some people.
And in our report, for example, we could have a paragraph that says, by community spirit, we mean these are signs of what it is we need, but these are the things we'll be measuring, you know.
Under impact.
Yeah, or any explanatory note.
And I think you could find people right now in Grafton who think that there is a good sense of community spirit amongst their little group.
Well, yeah.
And
yeah.
Just because all those groups aren't getting along doesn't necessarily mean there's no community spirit.
There's still neighbors helping neighbors.
Exactly.
Put together things that, this program meets this mission. We offered this type of thing 3 times a year, and then 4 times a year, and then 5 times a year, and we saw participation go up or down, or whatever it is. And, you know, if we fail on some of those things, that means we kind of messed up one of our vision statements, right?
Either that, or we need to tweak our approach.
We need to either tweak our approach, or our mission is off the mark. Or, you know?
Yeah.
So that's how I would look at it.
Yeah. I do as well, because I find when people, when they set benchmarks or targets and don't meet them and don't want to reveal that because they feel like they failed, that's the wrong approach.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't meet the mark, you need to understand why.
Right.
And regroup.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
I would like to see something in here about communication.
Right. But that's not really impact. Let me just make a point. I think that belongs under strategic priorities.
Oh, okay.
How are we going to do these things? I mean, I don't want too many categories, but clearly addressing the communications has got to be one of our hacks. How are we going to move towards this vision? I'm going to start another paper. Keep going. I'm talking too much. Volunteer utilization. But I don't think that means
use of volunteers is going to be a key priority for the commission.
It is key. And you need it key.
And then what was the last thing I didn't quite catch? I was following two trains of conversation. I think, Karen, what did you just mention about?
Oh, I just said I think it's very important to find out about whether we're allowed to have volunteers
right.
there without.
Exactly. Okay. We've really been pounding away for the last hour and a half. In my experience, people start to wait after 90 minutes of this kind of thing. So I don't want to exhaust people with it. I'd like to suggest that I fold into intended impact the input from this conversation, and that people pledge to me to send back to me their reactions to what I do between this meeting and the next around how we might track our progress towards our mission and vision.
I can do better this time. I don't have any vacations planned.
I do, so.
So do I.
I'm going to a wedding. A post-COVID wedding in California. We'll see relatives for the first time in a year and a half.
Wow.
August 4th.
That's coming right up.
It is coming. After I move my kids to Presto. This is crazy. My grandchildren. In any case, so, let's take a quick look, because it's a little easier, to the value statements. And sometimes people think this is fluff, but if you can articulate what your values are, it can often help you decide how you're going to pursue your mission and vision. It's also, I've found for staff, really great to have values articulated and on a poster on the wall. It makes you feel good about what you're doing.
I think it would also give people an opportunity to say how the library is or isn't meeting those values for them.
Exactly. This is our intent, and we'll always fall short.
Yeah, but to get feedback about those specific things, it would be really nice.
And the second one is absolutely connected to how we would implement our vision. Should everything be free? It isn't in all libraries. I think in Grafton, it's pretty much essential.
Yeah.
Everything the library does is free.
With the exception of copies.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's not even anything to be paid for. Copies or printing or, you know.
Right, right. But any program.
Right.
In any service that we offer. Fundraiser, the Hubble does, is a different event because it's a fundraiser.
Right. Yeah.
And that's a choice to participate or purchase. Or
yeah.
Honorary book, and it's either a dollar or, you know.
And number three is kind of a throwaway. What organization, to get to Gary's point, is about it again. But. We can just take that out. A lot of people like having. Here again is another affirmation. Sometimes the same concept can find its way into more than one statement.
Mm-hmm. Is this all about transparency?
What? Stewardship?
Number three. Yeah, the number three.
No.
I mean, I think
no.
a lot of people.
No, it's about you're misusing these funds. You're doing it wastefully. There's a cheaper way to do it. What's wrong with you? That's what it's about.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Decide to do something, we have to ask ourselves, is this the most cost-effective way to do
yes.
it? We have very limited resources.
But I think it also, again, I think it invites people to give feedback on,
yes.
like, hey, I found this other way to do this then.
Or, you know, we want this service, and Canaan also offers it. Is it cost-effective? Is it really important that we do it too? Or should we just be sending people to Canaan?
Mm-hmm. Or should we collaborate?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I like it in there. I'm just saying it's up to you. I think it's important to call out collaboration as a value as well.
Mm-hmm. Can I just comment? On the last one, I don't see how it works unless we communicate financial information, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, more openly. Who really knows? I mean, we've got two people here trying to learn how to be treasurer. This is not a straightforward function. There's lots of little walkways. I don't know why I got set up like this, but it is what it is. But nobody knows anything. What do they know? If they don't come to our meeting, they don't know whether we're on budget or not.
Well, I think on that note, George, even in your meeting, I've never heard you guys talk about numbers. Did you get a treasury report? Yeah, I got a treasury report. I want you to approve the treasury report. Nobody
did last time.
Oh, did you? Mm-hmm. Sure. You started that when I was in there, sure.
Well, I'm just getting settled in my chair.
Achievable